was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
All that exercise up here, I'm gonna need your assistance. Gotta catch my breath just a little bit. Hallelujah. How great is our God? When the sun is shining, how great is our God? When it's raining, how great is our God? When you're in your feelings, how great is our God? So when I sing, oh, with me, sing with me, sing with me, how great is our God? Lord Jesus, move me out of the way. Heavenly Father, let your spirit come in. Use me today, Heavenly Father, to touch your soul, to touch your spirit.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and the very darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Oh, oh, how great is our God. How great. The lion and the lamb, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God.
and how he continues to bless me. Then sing.
Moment. We thank you for times past, times present, and times to come. We know, dear gracious Father, that only what we do for you will last. Now, O God, I lift up this waiting congregation. Speak to our hearts, O God. Use my tongue to tell stories that men might be saved. Use my mind to process the relationship that we have with Thee. Use my heart to share the compassion that You shared with us on Calvary. O God, I pray now that You would move in such a way that we might not leave this place the same way that we entered in, but we might be able to seek Your face even the more, that You might be glorified and magnified, not only in our talk, but also in our walk. O God, we confess our sins unto Thee, those that we are aware of and those that we are not aware of, and we ask for Your forgiveness and Your cleansing. For You promised us in Your word that if we would confess, You would be faithful to forgive. Now, O God, I pray that You would touch our hearts, inspire and also motivate us to touch a dying person on their way to damnation, that we might speak life into them before it's everlasting too late. Now, O God, as we come before Your throne, I pray now that You would humble us, I stand too arrogantly, I ask that you would make me humble. But if I stand with too much fear, I pray that you'd give me courage, that I might proclaim an uncompromising gospel that declares you as Lord of Lords, King of Kings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We have been walking in the book of 1 John, and we're going to stay there in the first chapter of 1 John. I know I threw the media team off, and I wanted to talk to us this morning from that first chapter, how to walk in the light. How to walk in the light. John 1, 1 through 10 reads from the Holman Christian Standard Version. What was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have observed and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, that life was revealed and we have seen it, and we testify and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us, what we have seen and heard and also declare to you, so that you may have fellowship along with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. Now, this is the message that we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. There is absolutely no darkness in him. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we are lying and are not practicing the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. You might be seated in the presence of the Lord. How do we walk in the light? Why is it important to walk in the light? Well, some reasons are obvious, that you know you can't see clearly in the darkness. But some of us are different kinds of Christians. And some of us, we don't really want to walk in the light. Some of us are cockroach Christians. Did you realize that there are 4,600 species of cockroaches in the world? cockroaches have been around for over 300 million years. Some of the scientists say as much as 320 million years. Cockroach is something that an insect that you just can't seem to get rid of. A cockroach, in most cases, is a nocturnal being. In other words, a cockroach is one that creeps in the night, in the darkness, under the cover of darkness. Some of us call ourselves Christians walking in the light, and yet nocturnally we do our best dirt. One of the things you need to be mindful of is that you can't walk with God and be a cockroach Christian. How do we walk in the light? Well, let's first ask the question, why is it that cockroaches walk around in the darkness? Right. Have you ever, I don't know about y'all, but we used to have cockroaches. Amen. I don't know about, some of y'all have just been so fresh. Y'all don't know nothing. When Vanessa first seen a cockroach, oh, she about had a fit. But I was used to cockroaches, because I had seen them in action. Amen. And you know, as a kid, when we was little, we would play games, wouldn't we, Tony? We would come down to the kitchen along about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. And we would flip on the light switch and watch them run. And they'd be some running boogers. You know, sometimes we ought to flip the lights on you and watch you run a little while. In this text, John is saying to us, we don't want to be cockroach Christians. Listen to what he says. Verse 5, he says, now, this is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light, and there is absolutely no darkness in him. Now, when we look at this text, first and foremost, John makes a declaration, a proclamation. He shares with us the attributes of God is light. Yes, yes, and within him, there's no darkness. There's no lies. And when we look at the illustrations, or we look at the metaphors used in this text, he talks about light and dark. So a lot of us, we look at just simply the way that we live. In the Old Testament, light was good and darkness was evil. In the New Testament, the light is sinless and darkness is sinful. But when we look at this text, we need to be mindful as bodies, as the children of God, that John is not talking to those that are unsaved. John's words today are talking to people who have stuck their sword in the sands of Christendom and said that I am a child of God. And so he says, listen, let's look at the evidence of where your Christendom lies. All right. Most of us, we will look at this thing and he'll say, listen, I need to proclaim to you and I need to share with you what I've heard so that you might have koinonia, fellowship with God. Now remember in verse 3, he talked about fellowship with one another. He established a connection between us. Then he shared with us in verse 4, he says, what comes out of the fellowship with one another ought to be the completeness of joy in our walk with one another. You see, the thing that is so disturbing about children of God today is that we hate each other more than we hate the folk in the world.
Amen.
We can't get along with each other. We are talking about each other. We are sniping each other, but we still call ourselves Christian. Koinonia is a fellowship. It is a connection in such a way that it is not superficial. Koinonia is a fellowship that is rooted deep within our personal substance and who we are. It is not that I just see you on Sunday morning, but there ought to be some connection with you that goes beyond just simply what I see on the surface. Angie, I like your hairdo, but there's something underneath that makes me want you even more because of the love that both of us have for Christ Jesus. It is the fellowship that makes the difference. It is not the dress that makes the difference. We need to understand that it is what is internal that makes the difference in our lives. John is starting to say and share with us the test of being able to walk in the light. We say that we come on Sunday morning and we are believers. We are members of the Word. And yet and still, we go outside and we cut the Word down.
Help us, God. Help us.
We don't contribute to the Word with either our time, our talent, or our treasure. We're too busy with life, and life is happening. So therefore, we are walking close to the light, but we're not walking in the light. Now, the significant thing about this text is that when he opens up the fifth verse, he says, God is light. But most of us look at this thing, and we kind of flip that thing around. We say, God is light. And light is God. Well, let me enlighten you. Because God is light, but light isn't God. Y'all need to understand that I can be light, but I'm not God. But the light of God resides in me. That's why Jesus said, don't you realize that you are the light of the world? And the light of God that shines from within you is that which men ought to see about you. So John picks up this text and he says, you claim to be Christian, but you're nothing but a cockroach in disguise, scurrying around, avoiding the light, though, so that you might do your dirt. The thing that you need to be mindful of is that just as there are variations of cockroaches, there are variations of Christians. There are different species of us in the place. And that's why we have such chaos amongst us. Because we tend to stand on doctrine more so than we stand on the Word of God. It's not about how you believe. It's all in who you believe. you believe. John is in this text. He's saying, listen, brethren, you need to understand that there's some false teachers amongst you. There are some brothers telling you just enough of the truth that will keep you off kilter. There's some folk there that tell you, and they stand on the Bible and the Word of God, but yet and still they twist it so that they can manipulate you in such a way that you don't understand the truth. Listen to the text as he walks through this text. I'm not going to try to be long, but I just want to understand this. First he says in the fifth verse, he says, now this is the message. What's the message we have heard? The Bible says, and the Word of God was flesh, and it dwelt among us. Paul picked it up like this, and he says, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that God raised him, who? The Word, from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Didn't mean no, it wasn't no maybe, it wasn't no if you walk like this, if you sing like this, if you speak in tongues, if you shout and tarry for the Holy Ghost. No, ain't none of that. It says if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. How do I walk in the light? I walk in Jesus' name. I don't need to do nothing else. When I woke up this morning, I woke up with my mind stayed on Jesus. Why? Because I needed to see the sin in my own life. Didn't have nothing to do with you. Didn't have nothing to do with worship this morning. When I woke up in worship. When I woke up in praise. Why? Because I knew the God that I serve. His mercies are new each and every day. No matter what I do, no matter what I say, God is new every day. It's not about the life that I live. Now listen, let me share with you. He says in this message, he says, we have heard, look, from him. I didn't hear this from nobody else but God. You come here on Sunday in and Sunday out hoping to get a word from Fletcher. I stopped by to share with you. You looking for the wrong place for what you need. I am merely the mailman carrying a letter from the master. He wrote it personally to each and every one of you. And that's why some of y'all get bent out of shape. You say, now, Pastor was in my business. No, I wasn't in your business this morning. All I did was deliver the mail from the Word of God and the person of God, that you might be able to hear the message of God to manifest itself in your life, that you might be able to walk in the light. All right. Now let me ask you a question. Why is it that you don't like the light? Why is it that you enjoy the darkness of the nightclub? I've been there before, and I don't know if they have them now, but they used to have, back in the day, they used to have a crystal ball in the corner. They still do. And what they would do is they would put a little laser light on the crystal ball. And you know what I'm talking about. Give me some. And the light and the colors would distort who I'm looking at. And you add to that.
Well,
a little libation.
Well,
and an ogre would look like Queen Elizabeth. But it was shrouded in darkness. And they just gave you enough light that you could tell about the shadows. You couldn't see any details. But what you need to understand, Christ delivered us with the light that we might be able to see. And the message. Look at this thing. Look at this thing. He says, the message we have heard from him and declare unto you. Now, cockroach Christians, they don't want to declare nothing to you. Gail, I got my blessing. I'm not telling nobody about my blessing because, you know, them folk, they envious. And they want to have my blessing, but they don't want to share nothing. And, you know, the problem with us is that we don't believe that God belongs to all of us, son. He's mine. But he's so much mine that he forces me to share him with you. You see, the challenge for us, we live in a world today that is enjoying your suffering. Either they envy what you have, and you ain't got much. Envy the relationship that you have with your family, and that is rocky. But yet and still, it doesn't matter. Someone is envying you for where you are. The one thing that we need to be mindful of is that the message of Christ is that, listen, it's not about what you have that makes the difference. It's who you have and where you find yourself. Because in this text, he's sharing with us, he says, listen, I've heard the message of Christ, and because of the blessings that it has brought in my life, I've got to share, I've got to declare that no matter what he does, or no matter where he goes, no matter how I'm there, he has covered me with his precious blood, cleansed me from all of my sin and unrighteousness. He looks at this text, he says, how do I walk? He starts to talk about the test. In this text, he says, first and foremost, you need to understand that there's no darkness in God. And most of us have come to the place or the position that God understands, and he just will let me have a little sin in my life. The scripture teaches us right here, there's absolutely no sin in him. As a matter of fact, when Jesus died on Calvary's tree, and the scripture says that he looked away, and Jesus asked, Father, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? And I submit to you that God did not forsake Jesus. He just simply, when Jesus became the sin that we are, God, being as a pure and a holy God, refused to look at the sin that had befallen on his son. He did not reject his son. He did not forsake his son, but he did forsake the sin that was on his son. And many of us need to understand that's what God forsakes about us. Because through the power of what Christ did on the cross, He has covered us with his blood. And so that when you are doing your dirt in your darkness, God has been watching you throughout your darkness, but the covering of the precious blood of the Lamb will not allow God to see you in your darkness, but he sees the blood of his Son on Calvary's tree. And through the blood of his Son on Calvary's tree, he sees the light that is there within you. And how do I get to that light, Brother Preacher? Well, Metris, you ask such good questions. Oh, I'm so glad you asked. The first way we need to understand is that we need to, one, look into the mirror of our own life and see that we are darkness made flesh. We need to understand, as David did, we were born in sin, shaped in iniquity. That's why John later on in this text said, listen, any man that says he has no sin, he makes God a liar. Why? Because all of us were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Every one of us in this place have fallen short of the glory of God. It doesn't matter if your position or your state, you have fallen short. And the message from God is that Christ, while I was in my mess, died for me that I might live. The thing that you have to ask yourself a question is, how do I live, Angie? Do I live in the shadows, slipping in and out of the darkness, trying to hide my sin? Or am I truly walking in the way and the will of God? That means I'm not just simply walking in a step by step for me. I hear Paul telling us in the 5th chapter of Ephesians, he says, walk worthy of the vocation of which you are called. You call yourself Christian, you ought to walk worthy of a Christian. Not just to say I go to church on Sunday, but I become the church on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and I celebrate on Sunday. You see, I don't come to church to get re-energized. I come to church to fellowship and celebrate with the saints and the Christmas lights of God. There's a star on the top of the Christmas tree, but the significance of the old school Christmas tree was the fact that there were Christmas trees that were strung up in what they call series, and that meant that it was a series of light that were interconnected with one another, so that when one light bulb went out, all of the lights went out. And so you had to take all the lights off the tree and go through the bulbs one by one to find out which one was dim. And then when you found the one that was dim, you replaced it with a new bulb. And then all of the lights came on. See, listen, y'all need to understand that the body of Christ is a series in Christmas lights. When one of us go out, all of us go out. That's why we ought to gather around one another, that we might encourage them to come back into the fold of God, that we all might light up the Christmas tree. Too many of us running our Christendom on independence and not interdependence. You see, the only thing you have to be mindful of is, Metris, you look like you got a question. Listen, let me share with you. Independence means that I stand alone. Interdependence means that I am alone, but I am connected to someone else. it says to me in interdependence that I am who I am in Christ, but I'm also connected in such a way that makes me the body of Christ. You see, the thing that's so awesome about God is that he doesn't take you out of being who you is. You are a raggedy sinner. You're still a raggedy sinner. But the difference is Christ has deposited in you a light that shines from within and makes you different than you used to be. But you're still raggedy on the outside. You know why you're raggedy on the outside, Steph? Because the body, the Bible says, absent from the body is present with the Lord. This body that you live in is going back to the dirt from which it came. And the only difference is that when you find yourself in Christ, you're no longer dirt of dirt, but you're dignified dirt. I'm dirt with a purpose. I'm dirt with passion. I'm dirt with power. Because God has made me what I am that he might be glorified in what I do. And so I can't just walk just because I look good. I have to walk because I am good. And it's not that what I do that makes me good. It's how I believe that makes me good. Why? Because I heard the message. Come unto me, all of you that are heavy laden, and I, Jesus Christ, will give you rest. Some of us, we don't know how to rest. Amen, lights and walls. They kind of looking at me like they don't know what I'm talking about. Can I talk to you for a minute? Life happens, walls. They seem to just don't understand that there are some things I cannot control. There are other things I can control. What can I control? Life or walls? I can't control life. I can't control what somebody else does or how somebody else thinks. But I can control what you have deposited in me through the Lord, as my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I can make a choice to call Jesus my Lord and Savior. I can make a choice to stand on the word of God. And when everything else is falling and crumbling around me, I can still stand on the solid rock that builds under me a foundation that I might not fall with the world. I can stand. I can understand that when I'm going through trouble and struggle, that's when God raises up to a standard, that he lifts me up out of the muck and the mire. I can change my mind and look into the heels of Jesus Christ, from which cometh all of my help. Oh, I hear the message of Jesus Christ. I can understand that I'm going to trust him no matter what. I can't control nobody else, but I can control my belief and faith in you. Walls, will you trust him with me? Because he's made a way out of no way. You see, the thing that's so awesome about the power of the word of God is that it steps out of yesterday. And it makes, and it brings value to today. But it places hope in tomorrow. You see, I can't change yesterday. But I know what yesterday has brought me. I know what I can do about yesterday. But if I'm experiencing the presence and the power of God today, it lets me know that today is the first day of the beginning of my blessings. But it's not just a blessing, it's just the fact that I have fellowship with God. I have koinonia, I have connection with God. And because I'm connected today, I can look forward to tomorrow. Paul said it like this: this life that I now live is no longer my own. Why? Because yesterday I was a sinner. Yesterday I was on my way to hell. But today Jesus stepped into my life. He offered me a new direction. He offered me a new way. And in my sanctified imagination, I told him, Candace, that today is the day that I put my hand in your hand. Today is the day that I put my heart in your heart. Today is the day that I make a difference in my life, because I surrender all that I am to you. But I can't stop there. Look at verse 6. He says, if we say we have fellowship with him. Now this is a good part. Can I put a Fletcher in that? If I say I'm a saint and I got fellowship with God, and I only come to worship when the pressure is on me, I have to ask myself a question. Do I really have fellowship with God? You know what I'm talking about, Madison. You sometimes you get in trouble. You know you're supposed to did your homework, and you didn't do your homework, and come up time for it to be turned in, you go to the lunchroom cafeteria and you scrambling to get, because you know you got to turn it in the next class. You scrambling trying to get it done. Then when you turn it in, you know it's all, got all kinds of mistakes and all kinds of struggles. But had you had done the homework when homework time was, you would not have been scratching and struggling to turn it in at the last moment. And then when you turned it in, it wasn't quite right. And then when the teacher gave it back to you and you got a disappointing grade, you get mad at the teacher. But it wasn't the teacher's fault. And many of us get mad with God because he gave us some homework that we didn't do. What homework did he give you, brother preacher? You asked such good question, Whitney. First, you got to get here on time. Because you got to see, you know, it ain't nothing like getting the good stuff and you only get a piece of it. Everything God has for me, I want all of it. And if you don't want yours, Jeff, I want yours too. But I know for a fact that I want to get here so I can get mine. You know, the thing about walking in fellowship with God, it's all right to be selfish. Yes, sir, it's all right. But at the same time, he causes us to share what we have. When you walk in fellowship with God, what he does is he speaks to your individual needs, but he causes you to understand that you're not in this thing alone. And when he has met your needs, we ought to be able to share the goodness of God with somebody else. The awesomeness of God is the fact that he has enough of himself to go around. And fellowship, that's when we go back to verse 3 and 4. He says, listen, First John said, listen, we got to have fellowship with one another. Because the thing that you need to be mindful of is that when you have fellowship with Christ on your own, some of the fellowship of Christ that you got, Reggie, has a way of filtering and falling off of you. But the thing that's so awesome is that since I'm so close to you, I'm able to gather in the crumbs that you don't want from God. And the crumbs that you refuse to take from God are a blessing and a fulfillment of my cup. I'm like David. I'm understanding that, listen, my cup runneth over. My cup runs over because of the crumbs that you refuse from God. Because I'm grateful for what he has given me. Because I'm grateful for what he's doing in your life. And that makes me a blessing, not only to him, but also to you. Look at this thing. He says to us, look at verse 6. He says, listen, if we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we are lying and not practicing the truth. Look at the thing. I'm going to stop here because I know I can't finish this. But look at this thing. Let's look in the mirror and ask ourselves the question, a series of questions. First, what is a lie? Look in the mirror and you say, I am. Because I'm always wearing a mask. I wear a mask for you folk in church. Then I wear a mask for the folk on my job. I even wear a mask for my family. Because there are some things that I'm ashamed of that I don't want them to know about. But at the same time, we cannot have koinonia through lies and falsehoods. It might hurt for a little while, but if we are in this thing together, what pulls out of us is the understanding that I cannot continue to live the life of a cockroach. I can't continue to run in the night and not be under the light of God and sharing the message of God, that I might be an example to someone else and they might be a blessing to me. Many of us, we throw away the blessings of God because we're hiding behind what we don't want others to know about us. In most cases, when we are doing things that we know that are wrong, we have a tendency to skirt or either hide from the people that know us best. That's why it's not just enough for us to be in the room. We need to watch and observe how we come together. The challenge for us is fellowship is not in just the gathering together. Fellowship is in our connection with one another. You come into the house of God, I ought to be able to feel where you are. Now, feeling has nothing to do with my salvation, but it has everything to do with my koinonia. Fellowship is bearing one another's burdens and also bearing my own. You know, we made a joke or we made light of the fact that I'm snaggletooth. But there are some of you that have been asking that question, but you have not asked me. You may not have made fun of me, but you may have been curious as to what's going on with my mouth. But at the same time, you never ask me. Why is that? Could it be that you didn't want to embarrass me or embarrass yourself? Or did you believe that if I asked him, he'll say, well, you nosy, mind your own business. Don't you understand that as a believer, everybody you're connected to is your business? Ain't nothing wrong with asking a question. Something wrong with dictating an answer. Allow people to answer for themselves. The message of Christ. Listen, I'm going to say this and then I'm going to stop. Jesus said that I've come that you might have life. Have it more abundantly. He didn't say, I've come that you would have life my way. He says, if you come to me, I will give you life abundantly. In other words, he says, it's not about a choice or a certain way. He just said, come to me. I will supply all of your needs according to my riches in glory. And many of us don't have much because we don't ask for the right things. Boy, this brother's heavy. Amen. Listen. We walk in the light together based on the message of the Word of God, not on what our opinions say. Because the awesomeness of what God is doing in our lives is that He has called each and every one of us to be light in a dark world. And you can't be light if you walk in darkness. Scripture says to us, light and dark cannot dwell in the same place. You've got to understand that all of us have sin, but all of us don't have to practice sin. One of the things that we need to be mindful of is that, listen, God has given us a choice to have life or not. No. Amen. I got to put you down. Amen. But let me give you an invitation, and I know there's so many things that we could talk about. But we need to make a choice today. How do I walk? Do I walk in and out of darkness? Come to church on Sunday to make me look good? I go back to living my life a lie during the week. You need to understand that sin is not going to ever disappear completely out of your life. But the scripture says we have an advocate. We have an attorney for our defense. And his name is Jesus. All of us are guilty of the crimes that we're charged with. But we have a public defender.
Thank you, God.
It's already been paid for.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
All we have to do is tell him the truth.
Wow.
All we have to do is put our case in his hands. All we have to do is understand that he's going to do what's best for us. The sad part about that is most of us, even though we have the attorney, we still lie to him. And we lie for a number of reasons. Sometimes we just lie just because we don't even want to face ourselves. today, you don't have to live a lie. Today, you can walk in the light. You don't have to continue to be a nocturnal Christian, a Christian that comes out on Sunday but goes back under the cover of darkness Sunday afternoon. Scripture says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation, deliverance. The thing that we need to be mindful of is that we need to be delivered from us. You are what's keeping you out of glory. You are the obstacle to the blessings of God, because you refuse to surrender. Songwriter says, all to Jesus I surrender, all to him I owe. Another songwriter says, on Christ,
yes,
the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Another songwriter said, amazing grace, how sweet,
yes, yes,
the sound,
yes, yes. Thank you, God.
That saved
wretch.
A wretch. Like me. I can imagine he had to look at himself when he penned those words. He had to understand that he wasn't as holy as he thought he was. It wasn't just what he seen on the outside, what he saw on the inside. Today you can make a choice. What are you saying, preacher? Well, some of you have been sitting in the chairs for years. Ain't changed your seat. Some of you have been coming Sunday in and Sunday out, but never have gotten active in ministry. How can a dying world receive a living Savior if the body of the Savior won't speak to the dying world? Some of you in your own family, you see people on their way to hell and you just let them go on. You ought to buy them a ticket on the train to glory. You ought to just simply share with them that, listen, I serve a Savior who said to me, with all of your problems, with all of your issues, with all of your lies, with all of your masks, come to me. And I'll make a way out of no way. It doesn't make any difference how bad it's been, no matter how ugly you have been. No matter how much dirt you've practiced in the past, I can clean you up today. Some of us have been on the battlefield and we still haven't got the message. Some of us are struggling. Don't know who to talk to. Don't even know how to talk to them. But I submit to you, Jesus said, you would just come to me with your burdens and your struggles. I'll give you deliverance. I'll give you rest. He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. In this very text, he says, if you will confess your sins,
yeah.
I will be faithful and just to cleanse you all unrighteousness and forgive you. See, that's the key right there. The doors of the church are open.
Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you, and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. Interested in worshiping with us again? Our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at lwbcindy. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you. Remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you.